The labor movement received a big boost on Tuesday when the National Labor Relations Board ruled that McDonald's is a joint employer of the workers at its franchise operations. If the ruling holds, McDonald's would be liable for labor and wage violations, and this could make it easier for fast food workers to unionize nationwide. The McDonald's Corporation had this to say. McDonald's will contest this allegation in the appropriate forum. McDonald's also believes that this decision changes the rules for thousands of small businesses and goes against decades of established law regarding the franchise model in the United States. Back at the table, David K. Johnston, contributing editor at Newsweek and professor at Syracuse University College of Law, and Ovik Roy, senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute and opinion editor at Forbes. And now joining us, Peter Suderman, senior editor at Reason Magazine and Reason.com, and Michelle Martin, a host at NPR, who is part of the Identity and Culture Unit. So nice to have you all. Is McDonald's right, though, that this suddenly challenges the notion of the franchise model, or is it really just about this model that is a McDonald's one that says, all right, you're a franchisee, but you have to use this kind of ketchup, these kinds of, I mean, there's different ways to franchise, some of which have relatively more flexibility versus less.
I think it's too soon to know exactly what the implications of this are going to be. We don't have a huge amount of details from the NLRB on this yet, but I think it's potentially a big blow to the franchise model in the United States, and I think that that is a real problem for small business owners, and in particular for minorities and immigrants, because minorities and immigrants actually own franchises at a much higher rate than they own other types of businesses. And so this is a key pathway to entrepreneurship, to ownership for minorities and immigrants. And if you take that away and you make it harder for them to get franchises, or the franchise model goes away entirely, what you end up doing is putting more power in the hands of a big corporations in the hands of these corporate units rather than these small business owners.
So I appreciate the point here about the ways in which, I mean, for example, the McDonald's Black Owners and Franchisees Association is one of the strongest kind of, you know, small business ownership around people of color. I actually really do appreciate that as part of what's important about franchising. Part of what I'm interested in is, given that McDonald's is an international corporation that deals with different kinds of labor laws and practices, how does McDonald's operate, for example, in nations like Paris, France, God help me, my in-laws recently ate McDonald's in Paris. It was horrifying.
That's a lot more expensive
yeah,
in Paris,
yeah,
by
but,
the way.
So how do they manage
the fries
that, where there are very, very different labor laws?
This is a great point. So if you go to a Subway or a McDonald's in Europe, you'll find that it costs twice as much, three times as much, because the labor laws are much more heavily regulated, the wages are much more heavily mandated. And we talk about the concerns about the small businesses, owners, or the dignity of the people. What about the people who work there? The unemployment rate in this country is three times higher. It's 9.8% for people who haven't finished high school, compared to 3.1% for people who have a college degree. And these jobs are a gateway for those individuals. And so if you shut down these franchises, because that's going to happen, a lot of franchises will close.
I want to come back on exactly this. So we're back and trying to figure out if my in-laws are going to freak out because all the McDonald's will close. So let's go ahead and have this fight. So let's go all the way out with NLRB. Let's say that there is a ruling. Let's say that we end up with fast food workers able to unionize, and let's say they push for a $15 wage. How many McDonald's franchises are closing, and why do you say that that's unlikely to happen?
So first of all, I don't actually think it's going to be upheld in the courts, because we do have 32 years of precedent, both in the judicial system and NLRB's own rulings in the past, in the 1980s, that suggests that the franchise model does work. These franchisees, they do actually hire and fire people. They actually determine what the wages. McDonald's headquarters.
Sure, but I'm just asking for the thought experiment.
Basically, what all the evidence shows is that when you increase wages, you mandate increased wages, you have unionization, what happens? Two things happen. One, the cost of the goods and services provided goes up. So that's one way in which the costs factor down. The other thing is you actually hire less people and you have less franchises.
It'll be a combination
of cost increases and less franchises.
Isn't it true for those who want a smaller government, that the point that David's making, that in fact people who are working at McDonald's, at Walmart, at a variety of these low wage jobs, especially on tipped minimum, are in circumstances where they are then making use of SNAP, of Section 8, of various government programs because they simply cannot fill it. So isn't it much better to earn it as wages?
All else being equal, yes, it's better to earn it as wages. But what I would say about higher prices, specifically with McDonald's, is that if you've listened to what they have been telling their investors and the conversation that corporate has been having with investors over the last couple of years, they have been struggling to move their customer base off the dollar menu. Off the dollar menu. That means people cannot afford to pay more than just a couple of dollars for food.
Right.
And so very
But that's because they're making
that's
minimum
the wages
wage.
Are so
no,
low.
But I mean, but aren't these things connected? Like, so I mean, I love that you said that, right? Because if, in fact, you are a fast food restaurant for people who make minimum wage, then an increase in the minimum wage actually means the sale of your more expensive products, your $3 products instead of your $1 products. That is precisely why it is stimulative to have a higher minimum wage.
Here's the crux of the problem, Isla. We're talking nonstop about wages. We're not talking about the cost of living. And that's the other part of the equation. You can actually do things to make it less expensive to buy food, less expensive to buy clothes, less expensive to put a roof over your head. And all those things are going up. All those costs are going up because of government policy.
Yes, but,